y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and
singing,
all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
I looked at that and I thought to myself, you know, we're asking people to do something that they're in a spiritual conflict with God that they're not going to be able to do. Because the fight that you're battling is not with me or the church, is with yourself and God.
Man.
And you're not going to win that battle. Each person here has heard enough sermons about offering, about giving, to recognize that when you are in a situation, you're in there for a reason.
Amen. Man.
You can philosophize, you can ratify your mind, or whatever you want to say, but the scriptures are going to hold out every time. Amen.
Man.
And so I thought this morning I would talk to you about choices, and I talked to you about you ask for it. That's the title of the sermon. You ask for it. Because wherever you are in your life, you have basically asked for that situation in your life as an adult, especially when you become a child of God. Only the child of God can design his or her life.
Yes.
That ought to make some of you happy. If you knew that you could design your happiness, how many of you would design your happiness?
Man.
Amen. If you knew you could design your joy. See, one of the things that when you deal with folk who are struggling with the power of God is that they always talk about the power of the enemy to disrupt their life.
Preach.
But the enemy does not have more power than God.
No, he doesn't.
And God says that I've given you the power to construct your life.
Yes, sir.
And so if you're sad and you're depressed and you're dealing with something right now, then that is the life that you designed for yourself.
Amen.
You don't have to be sad. You don't have to be downhearted because you know God like you know God.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody should have preached to you by now
that
the Bible says in Romans 8, verse 31, 20 to 31, for we know that all things work together.
Yes, amen.
Let me say it again, that all things, the only people that believe in that, gonna shout right now, and the rest of them are gonna say, I don't believe in it. So I don't expect you to shout, but if there be three people that believe that all things will work together
for good,
for those who know, who have experienced
the
Lord, who have hoped His design will, you ought to shout right now. But God don't make the choice for you. Let me say, God is a God of choices. But what God did in His infinite wisdom is said, I'm going to set up a system in which you'll have power to construct your life.
Man.
Do you understand? You have power to construct your life. You design how much money you want to make.
Oh,
you design where you want to work.
Uh-huh.
You decide how you want to live. You decide how you want to feel. Somebody asked me, what's wrong with you? How you doing? You say, I'm living my best life. I'm living my best life.
Man.
I'm living my best life. If I'm living, that's my best life. Amen.
Man.
I'm glad to be living. Y'all know what I'm
saying? Yes.
But you're, how you doing? I'm living my best life right now. Amen. And I'm enjoying because I designed my happiness. The church don't make me happy. Folk don't control my happiness. I make me happy. And I'm pretty good at making me happy.
Oh, yeah.
You want to try making yourself happy.
Preach
it. Y'all know what I'm saying?
Amen. Amen.
Mirror? I've been unhappy for a long time.
I've been unhappy for a long time.
And today I'm going to be happy. Like I was when I was a baby. Sing it with me. If you're happy, ain't no clap your hands. If you're happy, ain't no clap your hands. If you're happy, ain't no anything to show. If you're happy. happy in the Lord.
Amen.
You have power. It all starts with Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse number 15. It starts right there. It starts right there. And one person brought up to me, and I don't know why people do this, because when you're talking to folk who understand you better than you understand you, you probably better listen than buck up against who's trying to help you. And so he said, well, you know, somebody made me angry. Well, nobody make you angry. You know, angry is a mediated response to the ability to control the stimulus. Let me say that again. Anger is a mediated response to control something you don't like.
Well,
that's what we get angry. Only folk who lose their temper, when you say I lost my temper, are folk who are not mature or folk who may not be well. But the same person gets angry and says they lose their temper because they have evaluated the stimulus, the circumstance, and have decided that they possess what it takes to take control of the situation.
Man.
Example. If a man, 6'9", 345 pounds, with a knife in his hand, walked up and slapped the taste out of your mouth, you'll probably look for the police and seek some help.
Oh, yeah.
Now, y'all jump bad that one in here. You're not likely to rush him and take flight. You're not going to throw nothing. Once he slapped the taste out of the saliva from your mouth, and you feel like you're about to pass out, you will seek attention. Now, you might be angry, but you have had a mediation in anger.
Oh, yeah.
You have thought to yourself, this big giant just slapped the saliva from my mouth. I want to do something to it, but I'm intelligent enough in my anger to know that that's probably not going to be a good idea.
Oh, yeah.
And you will seek and you'll holler out, somebody call
911.
Amen. Likewise, if someone 5'5", 120, walked up to you and slapped the taste out of your mouth, what's going to happen to you?
He about to get two
people. You're going to deal with it, because you're going to mediate in your mind that you possess what it takes in your anger to deal with or control the situation. Therefore, when folk are angry, and God says in his word, be angry but sin not, he is saying to mediate your decision and make a wise decision, evaluate if you really want to go down that street in the first place.
Man.
Everything we do with God is according to decision factors that we make every day, even if we don't want to own that we have the power to make decisions.
Man.
And so God says in his word, I've set before you heaven and earth. I've set before you good and bad, good and evil. I've set before you life and death.
Yes.
I've put you in a situation for you to mediate the circumstances and make decisions. But rest assured that when you make these decisions, when you come to these crossroads, there are going to be consequences concerning your decision, whether they are good consequences or bad consequences. Therefore, from the time that you're born, you make conscious decisions, whether you admit them or not, to either trust God or to trust yourself. And if you live your life mediating your thought process, determining that when something comes upon you, that you either choose God's way or choose your way, you have created the circumstances and the consequences that are found in the text. You have either have brought curses into your life or blessings in your life. Nobody did anything to you. We're either living cursed lives or good lives. We're living the abundant life or we're struggling in life. And we're struggling in life because we're making decisions based on the fact that we believe that we can fix ourselves and we can do better than what God has put in place. But God says, I'm not going to do anything to you but let you make decisions. You can choose right and have some good stuff happen in your life. You can choose being sneaky. You can choose being low down. You can choose sin. You can choose anger. You can choose trifling. And whatever trifling anger produces in your life, that's just what you are. And if you are a rattling right, you get regular results. Y'all ought to say amen. I'm frustrated. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 6 and verse number 23. For the wages of sin is death. reason, and it's your choice. Aren't you glad to serve God with choices? Here's the thing, I understand that if I make a decision to take on God and to live my life anyway and to live for the devil. Listen to what it says in the book of Romans chapter 6, around the 13th to 17th verse. He said, neither yield yourself, neither make decisions. Yeah, get your Bible. I'm hot today. Get your Bible. Let me just amaze you my ability to hold the context and the pretext and have some contextual preaching thing. Y'all ought to say amen. He said, don't you know, when you yield yourselves to sin, that's who you belong to. When you yield yourselves to this culture and you start acting like this culture and dressing like this culture and smoking what this culture drank and doing all the stuff they do, you get what this culture does. God didn't do anything to you. You're doing it to yourself.
Amen.
How many of y'all happy this morning?
Amen.
How many happy this morning? If you're happy this morning, it's because you probably making some good choices. And let me stop for station identification, because sometimes we can make some choices that seem like we're happy at the time. Amen. But really, the end thereof is nothing but death. Am I right about it? There's a way that seemeth right. Am I right about it? There's a way that seemeth right. The prophet writer said, there's a way that seemeth right unto me. Sometimes you can make some choices to get involved in a fornication relationship and show feel good. Am I right about it? He and she. Let me just stop it very quickly, because I can demonstrate in my own life as a minister where I made a decision that I just want to tell the church and I want to tell God that I'm sorry that I made certain decisions, but we were struggling and we needed to fill the pews and we needed some energy in the church, and I let folk come in the church and I let them work in the service and I let them sit by me and I let them talk to me and sit around me. They were married and dating somebody while they were married and shacking and doing all kind of stuff, fiddling stuff. And what I did is I made a decision that seemed good at the time, but it affected the church down the road. Am I right? Have you ever done that before? Have you ever done that before? You made a decision, you brought sin in around you and kept sinful things around you, and then you start getting sinful results. Start saying, man, it started out so good, but now it's so bad. Have y'all ever been there before?
Yeah.
Somebody know what I'm talking about right now. It seemed good at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But then the end of it was death and misery and frustration. And if you look at the text in Deuteronomy chapter 30, 15 through 19, he'll say that those decisions that we make not only affect us, but it affects generations to come. There are decisions that we make that not only affect you personally, but is affecting the church right now. One decision that we make is to give us sparingly. And the Bible says in Romans 9 and verse number 6 that when we make those decisions, the consequence affects the whole church. It not only affects you, but it affects us. We couldn't even help somebody who called and asked for a measly $100 who's in the hospital because $100 we didn't get last week in the collection plate. Somebody made a decision in the church to think about themselves and to make sure they have what they need. And that's your choice. You have a right to make your choice. But that choice and that battle that you're in that keeps you broke is affecting the church's ability to move forward with the ministry of the Lord. And God's not happy with that. This is what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Yeah, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, round verse number 6, what the Bible says. Somebody help me there. I can quote it, but I want you to see it, because I want to show you two choices that you make, that you're making. I want you to understand that how many of you are struggling right now financially? Raise your hand. Tell the truth, stay in the church. Amen. I like honest folks. If you're struggling financially, tell the truth, stay in the church. Why do you think you're struggling? Your job don't pay you enough money? That's what you think? You think your job pay you enough money? Don't you know God can take a minimum wage job and buy a bigger one if he wants to with it? Y'all don't know God like I know God. Y'all, why do you think you're struggling? Somebody say, why do you think you're struggling? Help me out. That's the name of the service. Why do you think you're struggling?
I
got a lot of bills. I got to pay my bills. Am I right about it? Oh, that's a good one. Am I right about it? But I heard the scripture say that if you should forget the Lord thy God in the book of Deuteronomy and forget that it's he that gave you your health and your what? righteousness. And all these things shall be evidence. And I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop so there. Here we come. When we start talking about bills, now they got quiet. We pay my bills. Can I ask you this question? Isn't it true that as hard as you've been paying your bills, they still not getting paid? Isn't that true? I mean, and just stop a minute. You've been deciding not to give, but that you can give to pay your bills. But are your bills paid? Don't wear out, wait. You get your car no pay? Y'all get your car no pay? Is it due next month? You got gas? Got some gas? Don't have no gas for you. You need some gas, don't you? You got to go, you need some gas. That's what this gas
man.
We would help you, but you don't give. You don't have to. I like to keep everybody turning on gas cards right now. But we don't, I can't raise no give. I like to take a Sunday. I told you this before I said this, that I'm gonna take a Sunday called Give Back Sunday and pick somebody in the church and do what?
Give it.
Just bless it.
Man.
But the congregation
don't give.
And so they fulfill the scriptures, the prophecy of the scripture. So even when you come to us for help, we can only give what you gave. And if you ain't gave nothing
to give.
We don't want to help you. We love to help you. But when you have
given little.
Y'all all right?
Man.
And even for you, now let me show you, I know that you need some sessions with me from a psychosis standpoint. For you to have the illuminated God to charge God with your thievery and your decisions borderlines on the very brink of spiritual retardation. Because the scriptures clearly teach that brother so-and-so, you make this decision. God not gonna bother you. You can make your sin go to a strip club and take all of your money. God not gonna kill you. Don't let your dad tell you. Don't let your mom tell you. You go in the strip club, put your money, throw, make it lame. Yeah, got the club going up on a Monday. Oh yeah. I'm not gonna make it rain. I'm gonna make it hurricane. Take all of God's money and drop it like it's hot. Oh, yeah. You do all of that. Look, Evan said, Lord, bless him. You do all of that. And God is just sitting down and looking at you. You know what God is making look at you? He said, I already put the stuff in motion that's going to take care of what you did. I'm not even going to get mad because a fool in his money. You can give her all your money. She's not going to give you nothing. You give her all your money. She works for the devil. Her job is to be stupid and to keep harassing her about money to buy her $200 purse when she don't have $20. Yeah. And you can go buy the $200 purse, hoping that you can get some sin for $200 purse for 2 minutes of up and down. And her $20 for $200 purse, and God's not going to do anything. God's not going to do anything.
Well.
Because by Wednesday, the creditors are going to start coming. And God sent the creditors to talk to you. And the creditors are going to say, do you have the $200 to maintain your car insurance?
Was it good?
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Do you have your car insurance? Now, there's a law that says if you don't have insurance, you're not supposed to be driving, and there's a $350 fine. But what's happening? From that one decision to appease the flesh, you now have your license in jeopardy. You now have the tension and the frustration in your body, struggling, trying to say how you're going to get the money. You're calling. You have to go to folks you don't want to talk to, ask them to help you. You had the money. God gave you the money. But you made a decision that on Sunday, God wasn't important, that you were going to somehow pay your bills, and you keep coming up short, and you're looking now like somebody owe you something. Well, I dare each and every one of you to listen to the scriptures and try to love. You tried this part. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, around the 6th verse, it says what?
But this I say
unto you,
he that soweth sparingly
shall what? Reap sparingly. What is God? How do you believe God's word is true? How many God's word is true? Now the opening text says that when I've set before you decisions to make. spouse don't give like you ought to give. A husband and wife don't give like they ought to give. A single folk don't give like that. If you so sparingly your time and only come to church on Sunday and won't even get to the Bible class, won't put all of you, your mind, body, and soul, into the kingdom of God, and you sparingly have a relationship with God, he said that by that decision, you will reap sparingly from God.
Man.
I don't feel God because you sparingly have a relationship with God. Well, what happened? I set before you good and evil, and you chose evil. I set before you life and death. Listen to the Bible again, Romans 6, 22, 23, for the wages of sin is death. That's what sin pays.
Man.
But God says in John 10 and verse 10, he said, the enemy cometh to kill, steal, and destroy, but I came that you might have abundant life.
Yes.
The text says, choose life and live. If you chose Jesus by the law and the power of God, he has to show up in your life.
Man. Yes, sir.
Please. He can't lie. He can't lie, and I dare you to choose Jesus. He has to show up, and he don't have to just show up. He said, I have to show up and be a bountiful in your, not sparingly, but a bound.
Amen, man, and man.
You done chosen death.
Oh,
yeah. He done stole everything from you. He done stole your youth, stole your vitality, stole your resilience, stole your power, stole your thinking, got you messed up, got your own stuff, got you jacked up, and you're giving everything to the devil, and God said the devil would do to you. But
man.
If you choose Jesus,
yes.
How many gonna choose Jesus?
Man.
He said, when I get in your life, I'm going to fulfill all of those empty spaces, and now that I am the source, you will always have resources,
man,
in your life.
Yes, sir.
You might not have it right now, but God said, I'll keep plenty of resources in your life. Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
Oh, y'all ought to be shouting.
Yes,
right now. All you got to do is choose Jesus and stop fooling with yourself and the devil.
Man.
Right? You can leave out of here on fire for the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Boy, that's
good. That's good.
Well, I have to go to New York next week. And so, a man, Brother Alvin preached one of the old Alvin sermons. And he might have a daddy go down there, because he's going to be here for this come first. And he's going to be here, he have a daddy go down there. And the deacon's going to be here, keep going. He's going to preach some Alvin sermons, where he's going to say, and the Lord will love you. And the Lord's going to help you. You just got to wait on the Lord. On the Lord. Let me hear one more time. Come on, let me hear it. Be
you
nice.
Don't want to hear.
Amen. 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 But when I get back, I want to show you that everything you're going through right now, who's making those decisions?
We are.
We are. I dare you to choose the other side. I dare you. I dare you to shut up in your mind just for a minute and obey God. I wonder what would happen if you stopped letting your inner thoughts control your external trajectory. Because every time you open your mouth, you speak yourself into the abyss of darkness. Because power of death and life is in
the tongue.
The tongue. Are you listening to me? And I want to stop right there. Because every time you open your mouth, you either speaking yourself out of something or speaking yourself into something. And I would say, sometimes you talk to me, I just want to look at you and say, shut up! Just shut up! That's why I get upset when I come to church and folk talking negative. Well, you just send the hell out of here. That's what it is. If you would shut up and let God put you in heaven and alive, everything would be all right. And so I encourage you, when I get back, to humble yourselves and try Jesus.
Man.
You tried all other stuff, but try Jesus. Anthony's going to close his eyes. I give the same invitation. But have a little talk with Jesus.
I was lost in sin.
You believe what you heard. You believe what you heard. Repent of your sin.